Most of the time in our lives, we don't know when enough is enough. We don't want to take too much, but yet we don't want to fall short or to be shortchanged. I was looking at a TV show one day where a woman was put into a big ball, and the whole ball was full of money, and she had this money flying all around her. And at a certain time, she was said and was told to grab as much as she could within the time specified. I think she had a minute. She used everything she could to collect as much money as she could. And when she heard the bell ring, she sat down and began to count. And it was a sizable amount of money. But she said to herself, if I would have just had more time, I would have gotten more. Saints, when tragedies happen in our lives, we often wonder, could we have done something different? When we lose a loved one, we wish that we say, could we have spent more time? Sometimes our lives are controlled by what we should have done rather than what we need to do. In our passage this morning, Jehu had reigned in Israel for some 28 years, and he was succeeded by his son, Jehoahaz. He reigned for 17 years. During this time, the Syrian armies had battered Israel, forces that Jehoahaz had only 50 horsemen left and 10 chariots and 10,000 footmen. This atrocity usually demands a change. However, these calamities didn't lead the people to think about repenting. They only thought about the tragedy they was in. Both Jehu and Jehoahaz had died, had did evil in the sight of God, and following them was their son, Jeroboam. Finally, the light had come on, and like Jonah, he finally realized that he was running away from God. He sought the Lord, and the Lord provided for him. Praise the Lord this morning that when you fall on your face, seeking the Lord's presence, he's always a very present help in the time of trouble. He provided for him a deliverance in his son, Joash. Under his reign, he defeated the army of Syria and reclaimed some of the lost cities for Israel. During this time, it was said that the prophet of Elijah was just out of the picture. Elijah was one of those powerful ones who reigned under several kings. This man of God was probably now out somewhere reminiscing of his ministry. He had been in place for years, probably in a private place by now. Sometimes, saints of God, after you've done all you can, you just got to pull away and do something for yourself. Can you say amen? Church, now he's all by himself, rejuvenating. He had served for over 60 years, and now he had just kind of gone out by himself. There's a story about how he started his ministry. We all know that. Elijah had begun to get old, and Elijah needed a successor in his ministry. He saw a young man out plowing the field. Can I say to you this morning, if you want God to grab you, start working. And if you want him to do something special with you, start working real hard. Now, an old man in his ministry, he spent over several kings, and some good and some bad. He had done the best he could to keep the minds of the people on the God of Israel. But many had rejected, many had turned a deaf ear to him and to the principles. He didn't stop. He continued to trust God. Without regrets now, he is now turning away. You see, God brings now Israel to mind. Actually, Joash was now beginning to see that everything he did was not what needed to be done. Joash started to out as a good king. Yet he had turned bad. He ended up that his end was worse than his beginning. God gave him some victories. Oh, I wish I could stop there for a moment, saints of God. Just because you stopped smoking don't mean you got all the victories.
Oh yeah, just because you don't go that way no more don't mean that you are all right with Jesus. He had taken Elijah's advice earlier, but now he was guilty of the same sins of Jeroboam. Elijah then continued to love him. He knew his heart. God knows that even when you have done your best, even when you have gone the last mile, he knows when you're having trouble. Even though Joash had grown wicked in himself, he still had respect for the man of God. He knew he didn't always worship the true God, but he appreciated having somebody in there that was faithful. Somebody who knew how to get to the hem of his garment. So he decided to make a call to the prophet. He wanted to go down and see him. Hadn't heard from him in years. Praise the Lord for those who visit. Entering into his room, he sees the condition of his this elderly prophet, and tears swelled up in his eyes, for he knew now that this man had worked himself down for the cause of Jesus. So he repeated the words that he had heard before. Oh, my father. My father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. I wonder, where had he heard that before? It appears that Elisha had reiterated to Joash the recount of what he had seen and how God had come close to him. You see, it was that time that he and his buddy Elijah had all had gone across the Jordan, and he had been promised that if you see me go, I'll give you anything that you ask for. What is it that you want? I want a double portion of the Holy Ghost power. And now our God had already decided that Elijah wasn't going to die, and God had backed up his chariot on the other side of Jordan. And when he looked up, all he could see was Elijah going off, and he said, oh, my father, my father, the horsemen of Israel, the chariots of Israel and the horsemen thereof. He recognized then that because he had gone, God had promised him to give him a double portion of his Holy Ghost power. And now left by himself on the side of the banks of Jordan, he knew that he couldn't depend on Elijah no more. He knew that now he had to walk by himself, and he knew that he would go back on the other side to a group of people that was hard-headed, that had once knew God and now had turned their back on him, that the school of the prophet had to be started and something had to be done, or Israel was going to be succumbed to Syria. And now he's standing there with only memories of what God had done through Elijah. Weeping bitterly, Joash began to think about all of the stories that he had probably heard and been repeated time after time again. When he's losing the most important person in your life, you remember everything they told you. When you're standing by the bedside and you know this is it, we reminisce of those wonderful things that he had. When he had been promised that God would keep Israel, and now it was a mess. When he had been promised that God would never leave them, he witnessed these great feats of Israel, and now God had left him alone. He was in a predicament, and the person that was closer to God is on his deathbed. Oh, I don't need to tell you this morning that the world is in a mess. What seems now that empty feelings come into Joash's heart. That feeling of loneliness and nearly hopelessness. When you're about to lose your best friend, you don't see yourself making it in this world without them. When they have been close to you and you knew the counsel that they were giving you kept you out of trouble, and you don't have them no more. When you have walked away from them and now you are back with them and you reminisced about how in the world can I make it without these words spoken by Elijah. Elijah now warmed the heart of Joash, and he sees that now he is about to step out on his own. Even though you've gone and gotten away from God, you have to realize that there's a time when you have to come back to your roots. There's a time when you know that you are out there too far. Sometimes you have to wander into somebody's house or wander into a church or somebody just knock on your door to remind you that this is where you need to be. Elisha gave him some instructions, strange instructions. He said to him, take your bow and arrow, a skilled warrior, if you will, that carried his weapons of war with him. Joash, willing to please this old prophet for the last time. He don't know what's going on in his mind, but in order for him to give his last request, he takes his bow and he takes his arrow and he puts the bow in his hand and he grips the arrow carefully. Elijah puts his hand on Joash's hand.
Now wait a minute. I teach archery, and I know that ain't nobody got no business interfering with me when I'm about to aim for a target. I know that two people on an arrow don't work. I know that if you are in control, that you have the ability to determine the destiny of that arrow. But there was something greater that Elijah wanted Joash to understand. He told him to open the window towards the east and shoot. Pull back as far as you can and let the arrow fly. Lord, there's something in here that you got to get, Church of the Living God. There's something that Elijah is trying to tell him. Joash, understand that he is now about to be left in charge of this without Elisha being a part of this domain anymore. God was about to remove the most powerful source in this kingdom, and it was going to leave it to Joash. So Joash now needs a lesson. What are you doing? I come to tell you this morning that even though the young man may have power, may have strength, may have the ability to pull the arrow back, you're going to need an old man's hand on you to guide. You're going to need somebody that's been in the trench already, that have already paved the way, that already know the way to go. It doesn't matter. You will not win this race, not by power, nor of God. Elijah's hand was weak and feeble, but he knew the way. Elijah didn't have enough energy to pull that powerful bow back, but he knew that if he could steady the hands of the one who was in the trenches, yes, he knew that if he could put his hand and keep his aim straight, that the promises and the power of God would always hit his target. He could point it in the direction, even though he didn't have power to pull it back. Saints of God, there's a combination in God's vineyard that says, I need you just as much as you need me. You have to know that the anchoring of God's holy word is not going to change.
Amen.
The ideas may be good and you may have fresh faces coming, but the direction is still going to be the same. I'm marching up the King's highway. As the arrow sped on its way, the prophet explained that this is prophetic, that the arrow is of the Lord and the symbol of deliverance from the Syrian army. If you would but aim right, if you would but just keep the principles, if you would walk the straight and narrow way, if
what you're doing. You are no match for that army out there. You are no match. The Syrian already got you surrounded. How do I know? Because there's 900 channels on the TV. Syrian already got you surrounded. How do I know? Because there's an internet that never sleeps. How do I know? Because there's more bars than there are churches. How do I know? Because the infiltration on the young mind from the world is greater than that of the church. You already surrounded. There's evil everywhere. Somebody got to stir you straight. Church has been engrossed in the world so long until sometimes we want to act like the world. Come on. Just open the window. Let me put my hand on your head. I'll stir you in the right way. Remember that we as saints of God are riding on the back of tried and proven ways, proven methods. We are listening to the wisdom of those who have already trotted this path. We are listening to those who have been through the trenches. This didn't start with us.
Amen.
The servant of the Lord is still true. She will never be outdated. Those who have come before you, who have built this, oh yes, we need another facility, but the facility will not negate the principles within it.
All right.
Y'all didn't hear me this morning.